Okay, good evening. So welcome to Business 2505, Section C. We're in the fall 2012 term. Today is Tuesday, September 11. And I'll start with a little bit of the course outline, but then after that today, I'm going to do Chapter 2, which is a review of what you did in 2504. And then I'm going to start Chapter 10, but I don't think I'll finish it today. I'm going to finish Chapter 10 next week. So course information, 2505C, obviously you're in the right section because that's the only section of 2505 in the fall. Just one thing I'd say is don't come through that door, always come through that door. My name is Mitch Murphy. As far as office hours, instead of having regularly scheduled office hours, which nobody ever comes to, what I'm doing is by appointment. So you send me an email. My email is mitch_murphy@carleton.ca. Send me an email and tell me when you want to meet me. We can meet either here at the, I have a instructor office at Carleton, or if you want to come meet me at my work at Sunbelt, which is just on Riverside Drive, corner of Hawksback, just next to Mooney's Bay. You can come meet me there, or come meet me. You know, we can schedule to meet before the class here or after the class or some other time. But it's a lot easier to meet at Sunbelt because there's lots of free parking. If you have a car and you're coming from somewhere else, you can just come meet me during the day at Sunbelt. But just make sure you schedule appointments because I'm a sales guy. So I go, I'm meeting clients all the time. I'm on the road a lot. So the reason why I don't want to have a set office hours is because that's just a 1 hour a week of time wasted for me because most of the time people don't show up. So I have absolutely no problem, you know, meeting people, but, you know, I'm going to be here when I'm meeting with somebody. I don't want to come here just to stare at the wall. The website is lemma.ca/2505C. Also, I'm also using WebCT. So the reason why I use my own web servers, because right now what I'm doing is recording the, by the way, we might change classroom. I checked earlier this summer, we were scheduled to be in a different classroom, and now we're in this one. The problem is that, you know, I got a tiny little blackboard here, so it's going to be difficult to be teaching. My teaching style is half slides, half blackboard. So I'm going to make a classroom change request so that I actually have, you know, at least a regular board. So we'll survive for today, maybe for one more week, but stay tuned. Check on WebCT. I'll make an announcement there once if I know that we have a new classroom. And I think also there's a sheet that gets put on the door at the same time. The textbook is Fundamentals of Corporate Finance. 7th edition, but 6th edition is also supported. There's no reason to have the latest edition. Just every couple of years they publish a new edition. They don't change any of the text in the chapters. All they do is change the numbers and the questions at the end of the chapter. And so I'm still using it because when I started teaching this course, we were using 6th edition. So all the materials like the suggested exercises, the solutions, all that stuff, the TA has done them both for 6th edition and 7th edition. And those are going to be posted on WebCT throughout the course. So you can use the 6th or 7th, makes no difference at all. And if you want extra practice, you can use both and then you have two sets of problems with differing numbers. So that's it about the textbook. About the grading, so there's going to be 4 quizzes in here, or maybe a different in class, September 25th, October 2nd, October 30th, and November 13th, which you get best 3 out of 4, and you get, that's 20%. If you have a justified absence, it means that you have to give me a doctor's note or some other kind of justification. Things that have happened in the past, for example, if you're you know, in varsity sports and you have an out-of-town game or something like that, that's also a valid absence. If you have some, you know, academic trip that you're doing, that's also valid. But, you know, I'm going to Mexico is not a valid excuse. So if you give me a justified absence with some documentation, then it's best 2 out of 3 or whatever. The alternative to the quizzes is to do what I call go help a real business. I'll explain that a little bit on the next slide, what that is. You'll have to have your timesheet handed in by the last class. The midterm is on October 16. Again, same thing applies with the absence policy. If you're going to miss, you need a justified absence, you need documentation. There's no deferreds. If you miss the midterm and you have a valid reason, the weight gets switched to the final exam. There's no deferred midterms or deferred quizzes. I don't do like two versions of midterms, two versions of quizzes. That's only for the final exam. And the final exam, 50%, and it's going to be sometimes in the exam period, which is between December 6th and 19. So make sure that you don't book your plane ticket out of here on the 17 or 18, because that would not be a justified absence. And when it comes to the final exam, if you miss that, it's not through me that you schedule, you know, like you produce your documentation and then you schedule the new one. It's through Registrar Service, I think it's called. So I handle the in-class. Obviously, the midterm is going to be in this classroom, or if we have a different classroom. The final exam is, if you miss it, then the deferred thing is organized through the university, not through me. And yeah, make sure that you don't put anything on your schedule for any time between December 6th and 19th. Because it's happened before that, you know, an exam is on the very last day of the exam period and somebody's like, oh, I've already booked my plane ticket. Well, I'm sorry, but we'll tell you in advance, it's your responsibility to be here for the final. There's no, you know, in 2504, we do this thing where, you know, we put more weight on the midterm or the final exam based on what you do better. We don't do that in this course. It's 30% for the midterm, 50% for the final exam. So let me talk about go help a real business. Before that, just a quick background of what I've done with my life. I've done all my education here. Bachelor's, MBA, and a PhD. After my bachelor's, I worked in websites for a while. Worked on some of the biggest websites around the world: Disney Store, Mercedes-Benz, BBC News. Which, by the way, BBC News, ironically, was not in England. It was actually in Amsterdam, because internet was a lot cheaper in Holland than it is in England. So BBC had their computer stuff running out of Amsterdam instead of London. Then I started a record store with some DJ friends. Didn't do too well, but I ended up selling it to a British record company. They did a lot better with it. Then after that, during my PhD, I started an environmental statistics company. So I was an expert on the Kyoto Protocol. Basically, I was a pollution accountant. You know, just did projects on pollution from cars, pollution from airplanes, factories, agriculture, that kind of stuff. And then Stephen Harper won the majority. And that was pretty much the end of the environment, so I had to find something else to do with my life. It was brutal. I mean, I lived through the dot-com crash, and the environment crash was, like, more severe and over a much shorter period. The people that I was working for, their budget got cut from $3.4 million to $900,000 to zero. Within 3 years, they were all on the street. So I ended up meeting the CEO of Sunbelt, which is a a franchise network of business brokers. I started in the valuation department, which is, you know, when somebody comes to Sunbelt and they want to sell their company, basically what I did is I analyzed the financial statements and came up with what the company's worth, which we call the MPSP, most probable selling price. And so I did that for a couple months, but then we were short of staff in the sales department, so I was transferred into sales. And recently what happened was we were getting a lot of calls from across the river, from the Quebec side, people saying, you know, I want to buy a business, what do you have for sale? And basically had nothing going on there. Sunbelt's been in Ottawa since 2002, so, you know, we do quite a bit of business, do about, between 40 and 100 transactions a year. Canada-wide, we have about 30 offices. We do about $100 million worth of transactions a year, but those are very small deals. Like, I'm not a big shot investment banker. I do, like, you know, hair salons and bakeries and restaurants and construction companies and, you know, trucking companies and stuff like that. Typical deal size for us is like, you know, 300,000 to a million. We're not doing like, you know, billion-dollar mergers. We're doing these little deals. But obviously, there's a lot more small businesses than our big businesses. So our deal volume, the amount of transactions that we do is quite high. I mean, there's some weeks where we close like 3-4 different deals. So what happened was we were getting a lot of calls from French people in Quebec saying, you know, I want to buy a business. What do you have for sale in Gatineau? And so the CEO, I grew up in Montreal. I'm French. My parents are, you know, as French as you can be. But I've been at Carleton since 1996. So I've been working in English for a long time. So the CEO comes into my office and I was like, oh, shit, am I in trouble? You know, I don't really see him that often. And he's like, you speak French, right? I'm like, yeah. He's like, okay, you're going to take care of Gatineau now. So that's how I ended up being the sales rep for Gatineau. And then what we found out is French business owners, if you have a 613 phone number, if you have an Ottawa address, they won't talk to you. So I'm now opening an office. Sunbelt is a franchise network. It's like Subway or some other thing, like... there's lots of different franchises. And so I'm buying right now the franchise for Western Quebec. And I bought a building about a couple weeks ago. Well, it's not closed. I mean, it's accepted offer. And we're in the middle of, you know, financing and inspection and all that. But I'm opening in the process of opening the Sunbelt office in Gatineau. So I'll be taking care of any businesses that are for sale. If you know the geography, from the Hawkesbury Bridge all the way to Abitibi, which is a kind of a northern region, but mostly focusing on Gatineau. That's what I've been doing. That's Mike. Yeah, but by the way, I'm not a prof. I'm only an instructor. I only work here part-time. I teach like, you know, 2 or 3 classes a year, usually just 1 or 2 per term. So I'm not here every day. I'm only here to teach this course. And so when you're booking an appointment with me, that's why, you know, you need to book an appointment, because it's not like you can just, you know, walk into my office on campus. I'm only here on Tuesday. But if you need me to come in, you know, especially around, you know, like quizzes or midterm, I have no problem. My office is like 2 minutes away. I just go up Colonel by Ox, back in Riverside. It's right there. So it's very, very close. What is Go Help a Real Business? Something that I was inspired from Dragon's Den, something that Kevin O'Leary had said to a pitcher one time, saying, you know, you have no idea the world of hurt you're about to get into running a real business. And so since you're business students, and eventually one day you'll be running real businesses, for me it's important that you have more than just a classroom education, that you're exposed to what businesses are like. So, you know, through my work at Sunbelt, you know, I know lots and lots of people around town, you know, in Ottawa and also in Gatineau. So if you're, The purpose of this project is, like I said, you can do the quizzes, or you can do this, and I have a database of all the small and medium businesses in Ottawa and in Gatineau. There's about 20,000 businesses, so don't tell me you can't find one, because there's 20,000. Email me. My email is mitch_murphy@carleton.ca to say which industries you're interested in. So, you know, send me an email, say, I'd like to work at a garage. Well, I know a garage guy, you know, that you could work with. I want to work with an arena. You know, I know the CFO of Bell Senseplex. What are some of the other ones? You know, restaurants, just about anything. You know, insurance companies. And also, did I put it there? I'll have 4 spots for people at Sunbelt working with me. Groups of 2 only. I don't want groups of 3, 4, 5 doing this. And I insist on, you know, I'll accept in special cases if you want to do it alone. But I much prefer that you work with a partner. I'm a big fan in terms of organizational behavior in business of the group of 2. Works very well. When you're alone, it's just that you don't have somebody else to bounce ideas. You just kind of keep something inside your head. It's good to have somebody else to work with. And then when you get to 3, then you always have one weakling that's just, you know, dragging their feet and that the other 2 have to carry. And so that's not fair. So I feel that the group of 2 is the perfect group size to do stuff with. You know, it works in lots of different places. Think of, you know, all the cop shows. There's all, you know, people are always partners. There's always 2. You know, you don't have, you know, 3 cops that are in a group, right? It's 2 cops together. So there's a reason, you know, I've been working for 20 years or so by now. You know, there's something about, the group of 2 that works really, really well. So I insist that you work 2 people. There's some exceptions. For example, the kind of businesses that you can do, if you have a parent or in general just a family relative that owns a business, that's a great thing. You know, I strongly encourage that you if your dad or your mom owns a business, that you go work with them for 20 hours and you learn the business with them. And obviously they're going to be motivated because, you know, hopefully they love you a little bit. So, they'll be more motivated than a perfect stranger to, you know, show you the ropes and so on. The whole purpose of this is for you to experience what running a real company is like. Because I can teach you stuff on the blackboard and with the slides, but, you know, you're quite naive about the world until you actually have a little bit of experience. And it's not like you need a lot of experience, just a little bit of experience helps. Once you finish your degree and you go get a job at, like, you know, Price Waterhouse or some big place like that, and then you go to the interview and there's, you know, 100 other people behind you doing the interview too, it's going to help you if you say, oh, I know how the garage industry works. Oh, I know how a restaurant works. I've done a school project there. I know how this and that works. It's going to help you a lot in understanding how what you learn in the classroom actually applies in a real world situation. Find the business yourself. So I'm not going to find it for you. It's, you know, just if you're shy, you know, this is the time to get over it while you're in school. Because in business, you have to be outgoing. You have to be able to connect with other people. It's a very important skill that you don't learn in the classroom. So find the business yourself. I'm going to help you with that. Like I said, I have the list of, so obviously this is a little bit small when you look at the slides. By the way, the slides are on the website, lemma.ca, and they're also posted on WebCT. So this is the list of all the different businesses in Ottawa. So you have 1,500 restaurants. And that's why restaurants are such a bad business to be in. There's just so many of them. It's almost impossible to make a profit in a restaurant. I mean, when I was in valuations at Sunbelt, I looked at a lot of the restaurants, I analyzed a lot of their financial statements, and they're horrid. You know, most restaurants barely break even. You know, just maybe 10-15% of them make money, and about a quarter of them the people are just losing their shirt. They think, oh, I'm going to open a restaurant and get rich, and then 2 years later, they lose all their money and they go away. So if you're going to start a business, my advice is stay away from restaurants. There's lots of beauty salons. There's lots of garages. What, 350 garages or 374 garages? There's women clothing stores, childcare, electrical contractors, fitness centers, landscaping companies, sporting goods stores, all kinds of stuff. So if there's a specific industry that you like, you don't have to tell me which partner you want. If you have a partner, fine. But the other thing too is if a bunch of people send me and I receive two emails from people that say, oh, I'd like to do something in a garage. And I get somebody else that say, oh, I'd like to do something in a garage. Well, I'm going to put you together. I would also appreciate that if you get a partner, you partner with somebody that you don't know. Just the thing about business and about business schools is about building friends that you're going to know for the rest of your career. So, you know, do projects with lots of people, make lots of friends, get used to interacting with lots of different people. So send me an email, tell me which one you would want, and then I'll get the TA to send you a list of all the businesses. Because we have, the TA started working as a TA here. Well, he started as a student in this class. Then he was a TA for this class. And then he was promoted again to working for me at Sunbelt. So, but I see him all the time. And so what you do is you send me, you know, I'd like to do something with sporting goods stores. And so in sporting goods stores, there's 123 sporting goods stores in Ottawa. So you tell me that, then what I do is I send you a list. It's got the list of all the sporting goods stores, the name, the business owner, the address, and the phone number. And it's up to you to pick up the phone and talk to them or go talk to them in person. Then, the other way that you can ask for a business list, I can't give you the whole database. That, you know, that would be some copyright issues there. But I don't think there's a problem with me, you know, giving you a small slice of it. The other way that you can ask for a group of business is by what are called FSAs, forward sortation area. Those are the four. That's the way that Canada Post splits their routes, and those are the first four letters. Well, call them letters and digits of a postal code. So say you live in Canada, so you can say send me all the businesses in K2K. Or you want something downtown, send me all the businesses in like K1A. K1A is like the market, like K1R, K2P. K1R and K1P are what's called center town. You got like Vanier's K1K, and then Orleans K1C, K4A, and so on. So you can ask for a business list either by industry or by postal code. And then we'll send you, and then it's up to you to contact them either by phone or in person, and then get somebody to, yeah.
We just say we want to work for free for 20 hours.
Exactly. Usually that's a pretty good deal for them. It's a good deal for you too, because I've had lots of students that say, oh, this is kind of lame, I don't really want to do this. And then they do it, and they, instead of doing 20 hours, they do like 30, 35 hours. They're like, wow, that was so much fun. So, and they learn, so, yeah. Okay, it's got to be business related. So, obviously, if it's in a restaurant, you can't go and cook or something. It's got to be, the reason why I say find the business and then get it approved by me. So what I do is I talk to the business owner and I discuss what you're going to be doing. It could be something related to, I'm not very strict, but it's got to be, it's not so much for me, but it's got to be, I have supervisors, I have bosses here. I can't just, send you to a golf place where you just hit golf balls for 20 hours. So you got to find something that's business related, specifically like accounting or finance. So it couldn't be going somewhere and saying, oh, I'm going to do like a marketing thing. You know, because you're not in the marketing course right now. My goal is to run this in the finance course for a couple of years and then convince the profs in other courses to do that too. But it's got to be, you know, it could be, for example, a lot of small business owners are flooded. It's tough running your own business. You know, so you could be doing bookkeeping. Yeah, it's a little bit less sophisticated than what you're, you know, studying. But from looking, from doing the bookkeeping of a business, you'll understand how that business works quite a bit. You know, where's the cash coming from? Where's the cash going? What's the seasonality? And so on. Like, you, for example, if you volunteer in a construction company, you'll notice how seasonal the cash flows are, right? The business makes no money while the ground is frozen. Then they start doing some sales activities in the spring. Then they have to buy their materials, so you have to finance the, you know, short-term finance, you know, line of credits, stuff like that, to buy the materials. They do the work over the summer, then they typically get paid over the fall. So that, you know, then you would understand that there's quite a bit of a challenge in if you look at just the per year number for construction company, it looks great. They're making lots of money, very healthy. But once you look at, you know, the month to month, once you start, you know, taking receipts and punching into to an accounting software, you'll start to understand a lot about how the business works. And that's what I'm trying to get you exposed to, for you to understand how the different style of businesses work. And then a couple of years later, when, you know, you're a big shot accountant or something, and you have a client in that industry, you're not completely, you know, you know a little bit. You've been exposed to that. So the point is for you to be exposed to a business for 20 hours. And in general, it could be finance related, it could be accounting, doing the bookkeeping, could be, for example, doing a cash flow forecast. Because we're going to be talking about a lot about, you know, I'm going to say the word cash flow so many times in this course that you'll be sick of it by the time I'm done. But for example, say I've had all kinds of weird things that people have done. One was a dairy farm where the farmer wanted to buy a tractor and he had to make like a 5-year cash flow forecast to go to the bank to get the loan for the equipment. So that's an example of something you can do. Anything that's, you know, where you're doing bookkeeping, not so much to learn bookkeeping, but so that by doing the bookkeeping, you see how the business works because you understand, you know, the different expenses, the different revenues. Anything that's finance related, so, you know, preparing business plans, not the sale and marketing part, but the finance part, you know, cash flow forecasts, you know, just talk to the business owner, ask him what they need help with, and then I'll talk to them on the phone, and then as long as I can come up with a story that I can justify to my bosses that it's somewhat related to this course, it's fine. But you can't just go do something and then at the end hand me the sheet and I say, oh, well, that's not related to this course. That's why I have a quality control step. Before you can start on your 20 hours, I need to talk to the business owner, usually for like, you know, 10, 15 minutes at the most. And we discuss, you know, what are you going to do? Is it, you know, related to the course? And then I say, okay, go ahead. That's fine. Or maybe I say, well, you know, that's not really appropriate. And people try to pull stuff on me all the time, but it's my judgment whether something is related to the course or not. But in general, anything that's accounting or finance should be fine. It's 20 hours. You don't have to be, if you're two students, you don't have to be there at the same time all the time. Because obviously there's, you know, I was a student too for a very long time. You know, did 3 degrees, so I know what being a student is like and how chaotic your schedule can be and, you know, coordinating with other people. If you have a partner, you don't have to be in the business always there at the same time. That's one question that people ask. You have to do the 20 hours. Then you fill a timesheet from the business manager or the owner. And then they sign it. So that's what the sheet looks like. That was the summer one. I'll just make the I'll just make one for 2505 CFall 2012, and I'll put it on WebCT. So you fill the business name, the address, who the manager is, their email, their phone number, what the two students doing the project is, and then you fill the timesheet, the date, and then if which students were there, what time you started, what time you stopped, and how much time that is. You add it up, and it should be at least 20 hours, and then it has to be signed by the business owner or the manager. Okay, so any questions at all about grading or, yeah?
So basically, we have to choose between the quiz and
yeah.
This one?
Yeah. I strongly suggest that if you're going to go help a real business, you still do the quizzes just to know the material. Because if you just wait till the midterm of the final exam, you're doing Go Help a Real Business, you might have kind of a bad surprise. But the way that my grading spreadsheet works is I have, you know, max of the best of 3 out of 4 quizzes or 20% for Go Help a Real Business. So one thing that's a good question. One thing that I suggest is because there is risk that, you know, you won't be able to find a business, especially for quiz one and quiz two, still do quiz one and quiz two. Because in case you're like, oh, I'm going to go help a real business, then you can't find one. And then quiz one has already happened and quiz two has already happened. Well, that's what, that's 5% of your grade down the drain. So make sure that you still do the quizzes, but if by the end you, because there's quite a bit of risk. Sometimes, you know, you think, oh, that guy said I could do it. And then you go back like 2 weeks later, it's like, oh, I'm too busy, I can't do it. So I'm warning you, there's quite a bit of risk in doing that. But as a finance student, you should understand the concept of high risk, high reward by now. So there's a higher risk of doing this, but you'll get a lot more reward. Yeah. No. If you do both of them, you already have perfect marks for that section. So for there's no bonus. Any other questions? Yeah.
20 hours each, right?
Yeah, 20 hours each student. Yeah.
Yes. What about if we do more?
Sorry?
What about if we do more hours?
Well, then it's up to you. Some, like I said, you got to do 20 hours, but so many students do this and they have so much fun doing it that, you know, when I see their sheet at the end, they ended up doing 23, 24, 25 hours. You still get 20%. You don't get more, but I've noticed a lot of students like it so much that they do a little bit more because they're so passionate about it. Yeah? Yeah, I am right now. So I refer, for this course, I'm recording the Blackboard with my webcam and also on a different video track. I'm recording what's on the slides, what's on the projector. Then I've trained the TA to do the video editing, and he does the camera cuts between the slides and the Blackboard. So we end up producing a QuickTime video that's got like, you know, the camera cuts in it. Any other questions? Okay, so let's start chapter 2. Now, chapter 2 is a review because you should have done chapter 2 in 2504. How many people did 2504, say, in last year? So most people, right? Like, how many people have done 2504, like, say, more than a year ago? Yeah. So make sure you listen carefully to chapter 2 because it's, yeah.
Is it the same book for last year?
Yeah. Yeah, it's the same book for 2504 is the first half of the textbook. 2505 is the second half of the textbook. But we review a little bit of stuff in 2505. Okay, so in chapter 2, 2.1 is a balance sheet and 2.2 is income statement. So we don't do that. We don't review that. This is first year accounting. The most important, my opinion, is the most important of the three statements is the cash flow statement. And it's too bad that in accounting, it's always thought as the very last thing, and it's not given the proper respect that it should have, because you can learn a lot more about a company from the cash flow statement than you can get from the income statement and the balance sheet. Here's the reason why is that hopefully you won't be one of them, but you can always find a crooked accountant to do some shenanigans with the balance sheet or to do some shenanigans with the income statement. You know, like capitalizing expenses and, you know, off-balance sheet liabilities, all kinds of... There's so many ways that, a crooked accountant can pull some shenanigans on the balance sheet and the income statement. With the cash flow statement, if you're auditing, for example, you call the bank of the company at the beginning of the year, say, how much cash in the account? Then at the end of the year, how much cash in the account? The difference was the cash flow for the year. That's not something that's, there's so many ways to fake things and, revenue recognition and depreciation and all these weird kind of things that you can pull with accounting statements that with the cash flow statements, if there's bonds and there's interest on those bonds, well, you call up the people that own those bonds and you say, did you get your interest payment or not? You call up the people that have the shares and you say, did you get your dividends payment or not? There's a lot of things that you can fake in the balance sheet, and there's a lot of things that you can fake in the income statement, but the cash flow statement is almost impossible to pull shenanigans on because you can't fake cash, right? The person, the investor knows if they got paid their interest or not, or they got paid their dividends or not. The bank knows how much cash there is in the bank account at the beginning of the year, how much cash there is in the bank account at the end of the year. There's no dirty tricks really that you can pull with the cash flow statement that you can pull with the other two. Now, taxes. The most important thing that we're going to, especially that's a big difference between 2505 and 2504, is a lot of times in 2504, we ignore taxes to simplify what the problem looks like. But throughout this course, we always care about what is the tax effect on the cash flow. Because the only measure of cash flow that matters is after-tax cash flow. Because you can make $1 million if you're paying 80% in taxes. Who cares that you made $1 million? You only got $200K in your pocket at the end of the day. So whenever throughout this course, we're going to look at capital budgeting decisions, we're going to look at leasing, all these different things. And we always care about what is the cash flow after you account for the taxes. So we're going to go through and I'm going to show you how to handle the tax effect in all the different problems that we're going to do throughout this course. And capital cost allowance is the Canada Revenue Agency version of depreciation. And so the reason why you need to know how CCA works is because it influences how much tax you pay, and therefore how much cash you have left after you pay your taxes. So it is the most important piece of information. I've already did my speech about that. Look how the cash is generated from assets and how it's paid to the providers of capital. So this is chapter one, but it explains how a company works in fairly, what is the essential way, the essential mechanism that a company works. A company gets capital from somewhere. It could be, it says financial market, short-term debt, but it could be the owner investing their own money. It could be a bank loan. It could be, family or friends. But you get money from somewhere. You take that money, and then you buy assets with. Then, so let's take the example of a landscaping company, right? Either I put $500 of my own money in, or I go to a bank and I get a loan for $500. I buy a lawnmower. So that's an asset. That's a company asset. Then I use that asset to generate revenue. So I go cut lawns. I receive the money for that. So that's the cash flow from assets. Well, now, it applies in anything. You could be like a taxi company, and you buy some cars, and then, you know, you collect fares or whatever. Or a computer company, and you, like graphic design, and you go and you buy yourself a nice Mac, and then you do some websites. Then you receive that money. So that's the cash flow from assets, the revenue that you generate minus the expenses. Then you can do three things with it. You can take that cash and put it back in the business. So say, obviously that'd be a pretty crappy business, but say you made $500 that summer cutting lawns with the lawnmower that you got. Well, what could you do? You could take that $500 and then buy a second lawnmower so that you'll grow the business that way. So that's reinvesting. You know, we're putting money back in the company. I'm sure you've heard that before. So that's the first thing you can do from the cash that those assets generate. The second thing is you got to pay your investors. So if you got a bank loan, you'll have to pay the interest on that bank loan and pay back the principal. If you have shares, you'll have to pay dividends to your investors. So that's how you pay back. So you have providers of capital that give you cash. You buy assets. You generate cash from those assets. Then you pay back your providers of capital. And obviously, you know, the governments, like the mafia, they always get their cut. So the taxes go to the government. So that's the three, you know, from the assets, that's the three parts of cash. Some of it goes back in the company. Some of it goes to paying your providers of capital, and some of it goes to the government. Another concept that we're going to use from accounting, but we use that in finance, is net working capital. What net working capital is, it's the difference between the current assets and the current liabilities. And you always want a company to have a positive net working capital. If you're a company that has more accounts payable than accounts receivable plus cash, you're essentially bankrupt, right? You don't have enough current assets to pay what you owe to people. And so you always, those are the, you know, the quick ratio and the, liquid ratio or something like that. That's what that measures. But what's really, to a finance guy, what's important is the difference between current assets and current liability. And that's what we call net working capital. So how does the cash flow in and out of a company? In the cash flow statement, it's split into three groups: operating activities, financing activities, and investing activities. So operating activities are everyday operations of the business. So what is it? It's if you have a cash sale, so if somebody, you know, comes into your store and they give you $20 for a piece of clothing, well, that's a cash sale. So you receive the cash right away. The sale happens, and at the same time, you receive the cash. Now, in a lot of businesses, you have what are called credit sales. So you sell something to somebody, and then you give them an invoice that say, you got to pay me in 30 days, you know, net 30. So on the moment that you sell something, you don't receive cash. So there's no cash flow that happens at the sale. What it does is it creates an account receivable. And then when that person pays you, when you receive the payment, then the cash comes in. So that's another thing that happens with the cash. Same thing on the other side of what you buy. You know, you either buy something and you pay when you buy it. So that would be a cash buy. You know, you have a supplier, you buy some, I don't know, cleaning supplies, and boom, you pay them and then they give you the product. Or you buy something from somewhere and then they send you an invoice and you have to pay it. So the cash doesn't happen when you buy something. The cash happens when you pay the invoice. So when you pay that invoice, it's cash going out. Obviously, the arrows mean, you know, cash sale, or received payment, or cash coming in, and then If you pay your accounts payable or if you have a cash purchase, then that's cash going out. Another big cash outflow would be employees. So you got to pay your salaries. And you can see that if a business doesn't have enough cash to pay the employees are not going to stay there very long. You know, like once, you know, if you're working somebody somewhere and, you know, they're not paying your paycheck, you're going to say, I'm going to go find a job somewhere else. The other one that's big, I don't have it on there, but I just realized from, you know, looking at a lot of financial statements of companies, the other big one is rent. Right? By the way, that's why restaurants don't make any money. After they pay their rent, after they buy their food, after they pay their employees, there's usually nothing left for the owner. That's why restaurants, I'm telling you, is the worst business in the world. So those are what we call operating activities, right? They're the operations, the day-to-day of the business. Financing is where you get the money to buy the assets that you're going to operate. So you can get it either through shareholders when it's equity, or bondholders or banks. In general, you could call them creditors when it's debt. So when you sell shares, you'll receive cash. So you'll sell, say, 100 shares to somebody, and they'll give you, say, $1,000. Now, when you pay dividends or you buy back the shares, then the cash is going the other way. The exact same thing happens with creditors, except that it's called buying bonds, or maybe, you know, you may be receiving the proceeds of a loan. And then the interest and the principal is a cash outflow back to the creditor. The last group is investing activity. So when you have the cash, you need a piece of equipment, so you buy fixed assets. Well, it could also be, I say fixed assets, but you could also be buying intangibles. For example, with me buying the Sunbelt franchise, I had to pay $25,000, but then I have the exclusive right to operate the Sunbelt business, the Sunbelt office within my territory for 10 years. So it's not just fixed assets. You can also be buying, maybe you're buying a patent from somewhere, or you're buying a trademark or something, but in general, you'll buy fixed assets. Right? You'll receive capital either from shareholders or from creditors, and then you'll use that cash to buy yourself a lawnmower, a taxi, a computer, whatever. And then if you use the equipment up until it's, you know, dead in the ground, then there won't be a cash flow at the end. But when we look at a lot of cash flow analysis in this course, we'll have what's called salvage. You don't use the equipment for its entire life. You might use it, you buy something new, maybe you use it for 5 years, then you sell it used to somebody. You know, sell it on eBay, Kijiji, whatever. That's called salvage. So you might buy, say like you're running a taxi thing out of the airport. Well, you're going to buy brand new cars, and you're not going to wait till the car is like, you know, rusted out, you know, falling apart to, you know, be picking up, you know, people like at the airport. So maybe you buy a, you know, brand new car, and after, you know, 2, 3, 4 years, you sell it back used, and then you get part of the cash back. So when we do project analysis, that's an important cash flow that you want to look at, right? Because if I buy a car for $50,000, well, it's not going to cost me the full $50,000 if I'm able to sell it used in 2, 3 years for $30,000. So then my actual cash cost would be the difference between what I bought it for and what I get to sell it used when I'm done with it. So that's the investing part. So operating cash flow, day-to-day activities of producing and selling. So, you know, buying supplies, paying employees, paying rent, stuff like that. And the next one is net capital spending, which is the difference between, in a given period, the difference between the new stuff you bought and the old stuff you got rid of. And it's also equal to, oh, by the way, this is an accounting concept. So net fixed assets are the fixed assets at cost, the way you carry them on the, remember how you do Hopefully you do from first year. You know, I buy something for $20,000, then it's got, say, accumulated depreciation of $5,000, and so my net, you know, after taking that depreciation is $15,000. So the net capital spending is the difference in fixed assets at the end minus the fixed assets at the start, or it's also the net fixed assets, the difference in net fixed assets, but you add back the depreciation, because when you go between the net fixed assets of the previous year and the next year, you subtract the depreciation for that year. But the depreciation is a non-cash thing, and when we talk about net capital spending, we're talking about a cash flow. So we want to take out the part that's non-cash. The last one is changes in net working capital. That's a concept that some students have a problem with because it's a difference of differences. Remember that net working capital is the difference between current assets and current liabilities. And so changes in net working capital is the difference between those two. It's the difference between current assets minus current liability of the end of the period minus current assets minus current liability at the beginning of the period. So it's a difference of difference. You'll see an example in a bit. Okay, it's 7:15, please, let's continue. So I was up to this example. Now, sorry, I'm going to be a little bit tight on, by the way, I was just telling one of the students that at the break, if you're looking for an accounting software, it's called GnuCash.org. It's open source, so it's free. It looks pretty much like QuickBooks or Simply Accounting, but it doesn't cost anything, and it's also available for Mac and Linux and also Windows. But if you're a Mac person, this is one of the only, trust me, I've been doing my own accounting for 12, 13 years now, and QuickBooks and Simply Accounting are not that great. At least this, and they're only available for Windows. If you're a Mac person like me, there's a Mac version of this, and it's also available for Windows, and I highly recommend it. It's an open source thing, so you don't have to pay for it. And it's almost as good as the ones you pay for. There's very little difference. Okay, so sorry, I'm going to be a little tight on the blackboard until maybe we get a classroom change, where I have like a decent sized blackboard, but sorry if you need to use a telescope to see what I'm doing. So the first example here is how to calculate operating cash flow. I have two examples. So the first one here is what we call top down, because you start with what the sales are and then you subtract until you get to what you need a couple numbers. And then you get the operating cash flow. I forgot earlier to in the earlier slides, but the formula for operating cash flow is EBIT, earnings before interest and taxes, plus the depreciation, because depreciation is it's in your income statement. But it's not cash coming out of your pocket or your bank account. So you add it back to get a measure of cash flow. But you have to pay taxes out in cash. And so the actual operating cash flow is EBIT plus depreciation minus taxes. So to get those, to figure out operating cash flow, first, we have to figure out what EBIT and taxes to pay will be. So you write, now accounting people write the income statement in a certain way, but you'll see the structure that I'm using for the income statement. That's the structure you should be using for this course. So sales. Now, do people see, should I start a little bit maybe to the, I'll start like right here. Well, sales, 16,500, less cost of goods sold,
which is $10,350. Now, when you say less something, you don't put the minus sign on it. Because if you said less, and then you put a negative amount, what you mean is you're adding. If I said less COGS, and then I have minus 10,000, then what I would mean is plus 26. What I mean, when it's less, it reverses the sign. So if the number on the line is positive, you subtract it. If the number on the line is negative, you add it. So less cost of goods sold. Now, it's not in the textbook, but if you get a job in the real world at some point, you'll for sure hear this expression, OPEX, operating expense, as opposed to CAPEX. I'm sure you've heard this, like Intel announced that they're going to spend $2.2 billion on CAPEX. So CAPEX is capital expenditures, and OPEX is operating expenditures, so operating expenses. And then also depreciation. Now, these I'm going to put for most of the course, well, for all of the course, actually. What I had is I used to have, I've been teaching this course for a while. I think it's a like sixth or seventh time, or maybe the eighth time I teach this course. What I did is I had what I write on the board, but this summer I had the TA type up all of it, and I put it online. So if you go in WebCT, for each course I have, it's called PDF notes and slides. So the slides are these, and then the notes are the typed up things of what I put. So you don't have to like, you know, be like crazy writing everything I put on the board, because you can just download it from WebCT. The only thing is I didn't have the typed notes for just the first course. They're all typed for all the rest of the courses. But so today I'm using some handwritten notes that are not posted yet, but I'm going to give them to the TA tomorrow, and he's going to type them up. So right now, if you went on WebCT and looked at the notes for this course, it's only starting in chapter 10, because I forgot to give the chapter 2 type notes to the TA in the summertime. So I'm still using the handwritten ones, but later this week, or at the very, within a week, the TA will type up the rest of the chapter 2 notes, and then they'll be put up on WebCT. So everything I write on the board is typed into a PDF file, and it's available in WebCT in the folder PDF slides and slash notes. Just right now for today, I'm using the handwritten ones. So you get the EBIT. So you say, then you take out. So this is earnings before interest and taxes. So then we take off the interest, and then we'll take off the taxes later. So the interest is 900. That gives tax of TI. I'm lazy. I like acronyms, abbreviations. So if any of you are not sure of something I'm using, please ask, because if you're not sure, then probably a couple of other people in the class are not either. TI is taxable income. And then taxes are 34%. Yeah, the textbook must be pretty old on these tax rates, because right now the combined federal and Ontario tax rate is 15.5%, and the combined federal and Quebec tax rate is 19%. 34, it's been a while since the tax rate's been that high. So, running pretty low on space. So, the formula for operating cash flow is EBIT plus depreciation minus taxes. So the reason why I had to do my income statement is because I needed to figure out what is my EBIT, what is the depreciation, and what are the taxes. Normally you would also have the final line, you know, net income is equal to something, but we don't care. This is the only, the three numbers that we need are EBIT, depreciation, and taxes. So that's the operating cash flow. So the EBIT is 1912, the depreciation is 1120, and the taxes are 34408. And so the operating cash flow is 268792. Sorry, I have to write so small. I'll fix. Normally when I do this example, I have, you know, the income statement on one side, then I do the calculation on the other. But I'm going to complain enough to try to get a classroom with a proper blackboard. So stay tuned. We might have a different classroom for next week. So that's what we call top-down operating cash flow. We started with the sales, and then we went down the income statement, figured out all our numbers, then computed the operating cash flow. I do like that pushboard thing. I've never used one of those before. Because the thing with filming, I can't write, you know, on one board, then write on the other. I always got to write, you know, within my camera frame. So sometimes I'm a little bit tight, and I don't have, you know, that much backspace on what I'm doing. Okay, the next example about operating cash flow, this one is what we call bottom up. Instead of giving you the sales, more up to date, taxes 15%. Right now, Ontario is 15.5. So it's called bottom up because instead of starting at the sales and then going from the top down, you're given the net income, which is 46,750. But the net income in a lot of businesses is quite disconnected from the reality of the business owner. Because, you know, if you, for example, have a lot of depreciation, you might be showing very little net income, but making tons of cash, right? If you have an example, I did working on a deal of a chain of fitness gyms for sale, and the guy, you know, accounting net income breaks even, but that's because he's depreciating, you know, something like $700,000 worth of equipment. And so his net income was like, you know, $30,000, $40,000. But his actual cash flow that was coming in every year was like well over $200,000. So what we do is we start with the net income, and then we go back to get what the actual cash flow was. So in this case, what we want is EBIT, taxes, and we're also given the depreciation expense. So we got to get to EBIT. So first, we want to figure out if that was the net income, what was the taxable income? Right? It's called bottom up because we start at the bottom with the net income and now we're traveling up the income statement to figure out the numbers. So think of net income, right, is taxable income minus taxes. So what's that? It's taxable income minus the tax rate multiplied by the taxable income, right? How much you pay in taxes is what you have in taxable income multiplied by the tax rate. So you can rewrite this as taxable income times 1 minus T. This is pre-tax, and this is after-tax. You'll see this expression over and over and over again in this course. In chapter 16, in chapter 11, in chapter 17, where things are multiplied by the factor 1 minus t. What does that mean? When you multiply a number by 1 minus t, you're converting it from a pre-taxed amount to an after-tax amount. If you remember, for example, in 2504, where you had the average cost of capital, and remember you had the term plus weight of debt, cost of debt, 1 minus t. And so that was the cost of debt, but RD times 1 minus t was the after-tax cost of debt. So anytime you multiply an amount by 1 minus t, you're converting it from something that's pre-tax to something that's after-tax. The opposite is if you have something that's after-tax. Another example that we're going to do this is when we do leasing in this course, and we talk about, you know, my leasing payment is like $1,000 a month, but say my tax rate is 40%, and so after-tax I'm only really paying $600, right? You multiply by that 1 minus t. You'll see times 1 minus t over and over and over in this course. Like, that's how you go from a pre-tax lease payment to an after-tax lease payment, for example. So here, I have that net income is taxable income times 1 minus t. The other way of thinking it is, if your tax rate is 15%, then what you get to keep is 85% of your taxable income. That's another way of thinking about it. So net income, taxable income times 1 minus t. But if we want to go the other way, we want to go from an after-tax amount to a pre-tax amount, what we do is the opposite, right? So taxable income would be net income divided by 1 minus t. So when you multiply by 1 minus t, you're going from pre-tax to after-tax. When you divide by 1 minus t, you're going from after-tax to pre-tax. So you're going from up to here. So 46,750 divided by 1 minus, I already have it, but thank you. And so then you can figure out what is 15% of 55,000. That's 8,250. You know the interest is 10,000. So then you know that EBIT is 65,000. So now you have sorry I have to erase so much. I'm kind of short on Blackboard real estate. Remember that the formula for operating cash flow is EBIT plus depreciation minus taxes. And so now I got my EBIT, I got my taxes, and I know from what the depreciation is. So my operating cash flow is going to be 65,000. Depreciation is 20,000. And then taxes are 8,250. So my operating cash flow would be 76,750. Next example, if I'm going too fast, you know, and you miss something for the notes, you can always go to the video replay later.
So the next one is net capital spending. That one's quite simple. If
you purchase 212,000 of new equipment, that was a cash outflow of 212,000. And you also at the same time got 133,500 for the old stuff that you got rid of. 133,500. And therefore, your net capital spending for the year would have been 78,500. So there's two ways of getting to net capital spending. It's either the difference between your purchases and your salvage, or it's also the difference between your net fixed assets, but with the depreciation added back because it's non-cash. So there's two ways to get to the same number. But just depending on what the way that the data is given to you in the question, in this case, depreciation, when you talk about a cash flow, depreciation is just it's a creation of the imagination of accounts. It's not actual cash that's going in and out of your pocket. So now we're going to talk, well, I should just go a little bit further. In accounting, you have what's called the balance sheet identity, right? That basically looks like that. You have your assets, and then you have your liabilities and your equity put together. So the assets are equal to liability plus equity. All right, this is the total of the assets are always the same as the total liabilities plus the total of the equity, right? Otherwise, if it's not, if you know assets are different than liabilities plus equity, then your balance sheet is not balanced. In the cash flow statement, you have a similar concept. Just like you have something that you could call kind of a conservation law, that things have to be, they have to be equal by definition. The reason why that actually happens, by the way, is because of double entry accounting. When you do double entries, that's the reason why it would always balance for that purpose. If you're not doing that, if your entries are not, if they're not proper double entries, then you will end up with a difference between the left side of your balance sheet and the right side. When you talk about the cash flow statement, we have a similar concept, and it's called the cash flow identity. You have something called cash flow from assets. Now, other people, and it's quite common, another expression for this is free cash flow. You'll hear that expression somewhere else. Quite common, but it's not actually used in this textbook. In this textbook, what is, in common practice used, called free cash flow. In this textbook, it's called cash flow from assets. Cash flow from assets is equal to two different things that are always the same. It's equal to operating cash flow minus what you put in capital spending, minus the extra net working capital that you're putting into your business. What's an example, and when you're running a business, of a change in net working capital? Say I'm a retail store, right? And I got maybe 1,000 square feet.
if say like I expand, you know, and I get say a 2,000 square foot location, then I'm gonna have more goods, more product on the retail floor. Well, inventory is a current asset, right? So if you double the amount of product that you carry in your retail store, you have to put some cash into net working capital, right? You have to, or say you have one retail store and you want to open another one, right? You can't just take half of the inventory in the first one and put in the other one. Like, your shelves are going to be half empty. So you're going to need to invest new cash. You're going to put cash into net working capital, in this case, in this example, inventory. If your business is growing, say, and you're doing credit sales, you know, net 30 accounts receivable. If you double your sales, then your accounts receivable are also going to double. So you end up having more cash tied into net working capital again. That's why you say that even very successful company, especially high growth companies, they just inhale cash, because if you have a business model where there's a lot of net working capital, inventory or accounts receivable, if you double your revenue, you also double the amount of net working capital that you need. So that's a challenge for growing companies in some industries, is you need, even when you're doing super well and you're showing an accounting profit, you might have, you know, either flat cash flow or negative cash flow. And so you, even as you grow, you're doing so well, but you still need to go beg investors for more money to keep growing, because you need to finance your accounts receivable and you need to finance your inventory from somewhere. So this is what you would call the internal part of the cash flow equation. The other part is, how do you pay your investors? How do you pay back your providers of capital? So out of that cash, you will pay back your creditor. Well, you will have the cash flow to the creditors and cash flow to stockholders. So the arrows could be either way. But here you have, say, interest payments. Those are always an outflow. If you were, say, as a company, you were receiving interest income instead, it wouldn't show up in that part. It would either be in capital spending, because that would be, this is investing activities. So if, say, you're a company and you're making lots of money, but then you invest in, you know, bonds of another company, then it's not like, it's not in that part of your, it's not in the financing part of your cash flow statement. It would be in your investing part of your cash flow statement. And then if you're a bank and you're earning a spread between deposits and loans, then that would be in your operations. So if you're a financial institution, the interest that you receive is an operating cash flow. If you're a non-financial corporation, the interest you would receive would be as an investment, not through your own bonds. The other thing is the change in long-term debt. Now, that could go either way. If, say, if you get a new bank loan, or you issue some new bonds, then you would receive cash from, your long-term debt would go up, but you would receive cash. So I go to a bank, I borrow $1,000, I receive $1,000 cash, and I now have $1,000 more of debt. Same thing with the cash flow to shareholders. You have dividends. Those are an outflow. Maybe I should say, you know, this could go either way. This could go either way. Net capital spending could go either way. Net capital could go either way. Maybe I should put it this way. And then you have the change in common shares. And again, that could go either way. The only ones that interest is always an outflow, and dividends are always an outflow. So what the cash flow identity says is, whatever cash is coming in or leaving from the top to the external, to the
outside of the company has to be equal to what is coming in or out from the inside. You know, there's no company that magically creates money. You either, you know, make money through operations and then you pay back your bondholders or your shareholders. Or for example, if you're a company that's losing money, then the cash has to come from somewhere. So you're gonna fall into more debt, or you're gonna have to sell new equity, and then you're gonna then that cash would be going towards a loss in operating cash flow. But whatever the number is coming in has to be the same number going out and vice versa. It's not like you can have, say, like $1,500 coming in and $1,000 coming out. Where did that difference in $500 go? It doesn't happen like that. So cash flow to creditors is the interest paid on the debt less the difference in net new borrowing. I call this change in long-term debt. You'll see me use that symbol a lot, the triangle, capital letter delta in Greek. That means change in long-term debt. And so net new borrowing is the same as change in long-term debt. Cash flow to shareholders is the dividends you paid plus net new equity. So the new shares that you sold minus the old ones that you bought back. And so that's the same net new equity that's the same as that same thing. So let's do an example of a cash flow identity problem. That's a typical log problem for chapter two, right? You're given a balance sheet and you're given an income statement, and then you have to figure out all the different numbers that show up in the cash flow identity. So the first one is the operating cash flow. So that's EBIT plus depreciation minus taxes. And so that's 623. The next one, net capital spending. Now remember that there's two ways to get to net capital spending. It's either the difference between what you bought and what you sold in a given year, or another way to get to it, it's the difference between the net fixed assets, but you gotta add back depreciation because what's it, the change between net fixed asset from one year to the other is what you started with, and then plus what you bought, minus what you sold, minus depreciation. Depreciation is a non-cash thing, so you take the difference and you add it back, and that's how you get to the net capital spending. So net capital spending is the change in net fixed assets plus the depreciation. So the change in net fixed assets, it was 1704 at the end of the period. It started at 1556. And then in that difference, you have 180 of depreciation, but you add it back to get what the actual cash amount was. Then comes the change in net working capital. So So remember that the change in net working capital is a difference of differences. So it's the net working capital in 2006 minus the net working capital in 2005. And that's the current assets in 2006 minus the current liabilities in 2006 minus the difference between current assets in 2005. Minus the current liabilities in 2005. Cash flow from assets, it's equal to two things. You can get to it two different ways. Right? Either you get to it from the internal cash flow, which is operating cash flow minus net capital spending minus changes in net working capital, or you can get to it also by adding the cash flow to creditors and cash flow to shareholders. So when you're doing a problem like this in a quiz, midterm, or final, that's a nice check, right? Do it one way, do it the other, add them up. If you're not getting to the same number, you made a mistake somewhere. So in this case, we have, you know, the operating cash flow. We know the net capital spending. And we know the net working cap, the change in net working capital. So that's 623 minus 328. Minus 136, that gives me 159. So the next one is the cash flow to creditors. So the cash flow to creditors is the interest minus the change on long-term debt. So you paid $80 in interest, and then the debt went from, started at 500, but finished at 550. That means that you received an extra 50 in cash from selling new bonds or getting a new loan. So you so your total cash flow, and it's cash flow to creditors, is going to be, you paid 80 in interest, but you got 50 in new debt, so the net cash flow to creditors is 30. The cash flow to stockholders, very similar to cash flow to creditors, except you have dividends instead of interest payments, and you have common stock instead of long-term debt. Common stock, common shares, same thing. So in this case, you had 100, you paid 109 in dividends, but your common shares went down, right? They started, see the difference is the debt went up from 500 to 550. That means that you received 50 in cash from creditors. But when it comes to shareholders, the common stock went down from 600 to 580. And so you gave back $20 of cash to the shareholders. So that's the difference. Here, it's plus 50, but here it's minus 20. So in reality, the cash flow to shareholders was 129, because it was 109 of dividends, and then another 20 that you gave back to shareholders, so a share buyback. So if you look then at this picture from before, let's look at what's happening. So the cash flow from assets was 159. So you got 623 that came from operating cash flow. Net capital spending, you spent more in new equipment than you got back from salvaging old stuff. So $328 went to equipment, and your net working capital went up by 136. And so that's a typical picture, typical cash flow picture of a growing company that's profitable. Right? You make money from running your business, from operations. And then you take that cash and you buy yourself, you know, new toys. And at the same time, you put some money into net working capital. So maybe now you got to have more inventory, or you got to have more more accounts receivable because your credit sales are higher. Or maybe you just have more cash in your bank account. If you make money from your business and you don't pay it back to investors, where does it go? Because you're like, you know, what if, you know, I make $1,000, but I only have, say, to pay $100 in interest. Where does the other $900 go? It would increase your net working capital because it would end up going into your cash account. And so net working capital is composed of current assets minus current liabilities. So if the amount of cash that's in your bank account went up, that's the flow that's happening. It's increasing the net working capital. And net working capital is a very good thing to have. It's, you know, typically you want to have at least, you know, not all businesses are that well run, but you want to have at least 3 to 6 months, you know, of cash inside your bank account in case, you know, all of a sudden some of your customers are starting to stiff you, then at least you have money to pay your bills. Here, The net flow to creditors was 30, composed of 80 going to interest payments and 50 coming from new debt. The cash flow to shareholders was 129, composed of 109 going to dividends and 20 going to reducing your common shares, right? So when an investor gives you shares and then you give them cash, it reduces your common stock account on the equity line, but at the same time, it's a cash outflow. So then that's the arrow that way. So that's what the picture of that company looks like. All right, it's 8:10. Let's continue, please.
All right, so, okay, now we're going to talk about taxes. So, remember that it doesn't matter how much money you make. What really matters is how much money you make after you've paid your taxes, because that's what you get to keep in your pocket. So let's talk about how do taxes work. If in Canada, I'm sure lots of you have, hopefully, I strongly recommend that you do your own tax return so that you understand at least once or twice, so you understand how they work, and maybe throughout the year then, you know, it influences your behavior where you can do something smart to pay less taxes at the end. It's a good idea to do your own so that you understand these little things, all the different things that you can, all the different advantages. So for individuals in Canada, you have the form, which is called a T1. You also have, you know, other things called schedules, but the tax return for individuals are called T1. And if you're a sole proprietorship, or if you're a partnership, then you use this form. I'm not going to put that on the exam. What's the form name? But you have this form T125, and so you include that income as part of your individual tax return. If you're a corporation, well, anyway, that's the thing that you put in your individual tax return in your T1. If you're a corporation, you have something called a T2. So that's how you do your income tax for a corporation. There's also this. There's also another form, another legal form of organization called a trust, but we don't really cover that in this course. And then if you're a trust, then you have what's called the T3. So those are the three different types of taxpayers in the Canadian tax system. Individuals, sole proprietorship, and partnership are on the T1. Corporations have the T2, and trusts have the T3. So let's talk about tax rates or average tax. There's two types of tax rates that we can talk about. One is the average tax rate, and the other one is called the marginal tax rate. So the average tax rate is the total that you paid versus the total that you had in taxable income. The marginal tax rate is the rate that you pay on one extra dollar. So say I'm already making, say, $80,000. Then if I make $80,000 and one, then on that extra dollars, I would pay 34% tax. So I would pay 34 cents, and then I would keep 66 cents. So that's what marginal tax rate. Marginal means, you know, just one more, what's the rate on it. And when we do cash flow analysis, project analysis, that's the rate that's important. Because if you're, say, your corporation, say, is already doing, you know, $200,000 in profit, and then you look at, should I make this investment, this capital investment or not? Well, the tax that you're going to pay on that extra income from that project is going to be at the marginal rate, not at the, you know, at the beginning rate. So that's two very important concepts on figuring out how, you know, what tax you're going to pay on your, when we do, remember that you're going to hear this over and over again. After-tax cash flow. That's what we really analyze in this course. What is the after-tax cash flow of some kind of financial decision? So before we can figure that out, let's learn a little bit about how do tax rates work. Now, that's a lot more important, a lot more the case in the personal income tax system. In the corporate tax system, it's the same rate up to $500,000. But in the personal tax system, you have what are called tax brackets. So it's a way to have tax fairness to people that have that make less money. They pay a lower rate. That's what's called a progressive tax system, meaning that people that make more money pay a higher rate. So the, you know, 0 to 50,000, 50,000 to 75,000, Those are called tax brackets. So you calculate your taxable income, and then you figure out based on what bracket, and that's the bracket that you pay at. But it's not, you know, if your income is between 75 and 100, you don't pay 34% on, say, the whole 80,000. What you do is you pay 15% on the first 50,000, then you pay 25% on the next 25,000 after that, then you pay 34% on the next bracket after that, and so on, up until the point that you get to what you're making. And say if you're making like 125,000, then you pay 15 on the first 50, 25 on the next 25, 34% on the next 25, and what did I say, 150? Then you pay 39% of 50,000. So let me do that example for 178,500. So average tax rate means what is my total tax bill versus what is my taxable income. So before I can figure out what is the average tax rate, I need to figure out what is my tax payable. So in this case, you're going to pay 15% on 50K. Then you're going to pay 25% on the next 25K. Then you're going to pay 34% on the next 25K. And then you're going to pay 39% on whatever is above 100. What's happening is this. So on the first 50,000, you'll pay 15%. That's, you know, whatever that is. Then on 25,000, you'll pay 25%. Then on the 25,000 after that, you'll pay 34%. And you had a total of 178,500. And so whatever you haven't paid taxes up on, which would be in this case 39% on 178,500 minus 100K. So 78,500. So you basically then do the subtotal of each. So that's, this first part is the first slice. Then this is the second slice. Then that's the third slice. And that's 39% on whatever's left. Then you sum it up, which is 52,865. And then so the average rate is going to be what you pay divided by what your taxable income is, and so it's 52,865, and your taxable income was 178,500. Meaning that if you paid 52,865 of taxes and you had 178,500 of taxable income, your average rate over the whole amount is 29.6%. Yes?
Like the income over
335. Oh, then I forgot to put it. Then you would have another tax bracket. You know, I think on my next example, I have something like, oh no, I didn't. Yeah, it would be, you know, 335, then you'd have like a bracket for the remainder. Yeah, it's, yeah, that example is not very well designed. Sorry. So the marginal tax is, I'm already making $98,650. If I make an extra $13,000, what am I going to pay on that $13,000? So it's dependent on what you're already making, because that's what the marginal rate on that new income is going to be. So in this case, you're going to pay 34% on $13,000 of extra income, part of it is going to be paid at the 75 to 100K bracket. So $13,050 is going to be paid at 34%. And then the remainder of that $13,000 is going to be paid at the 39% bracket. So then your total tax, extra tax payable, and that $13,000 is going to be $5,250. So remember, average tax is the whole tax bill over the whole income, and marginal tax is the incremental tax that you pay on the incremental income. Sorry? Repeat it? You pay, the last part is, okay, if you've paid, if your current income is 98,000 and you make 13,000, 1350 of that 13,000 you're going to pay 34 on, but then whatever's left on top of that is going to be in the 39% bracket. So you're going to pay 39% on what's above 1350 up to the 13 that you made. Then you add those up and you get 5,000. Does that answer your question? So, capital cost allowance. What CCA is, whenever you do your financial statements, you can, you know, choose some way of doing your depreciation, you know, based on GAAP or something like that. But when it comes to calculating your taxes, CRA has their own, it's very annoying. Like, every accounting term, there's the exact mirror image of it, but they call it something different. So depreciation expense, CRA calls it capital cost allowance, and fixed assets, they call net fixed assets, they call it undepreciated capital cost. And then I think salvage, you know, they every accounting term, they have the exact mirror image, but they call it something else. Governments are pretty good, but you know, they like making their own stuff up. So CCA is the depreciation for calculating your tax that you, because remember that depreciation is an expense, and so that reduces the amount of income that you're going to pay tax on, but they specify a very strict way of how it's done, and sometimes it makes no sense based on regular accounting standards. Here's an example. A couple of years ago during the recession, they came up with this tax, you know, stimulus to encourage businesses to buy equipment. So what they did, before I finish, let me just explain the half-year rule, so it will make sense. The half-year rule is, if you buy something in the middle of the year, say if you bought it, if you bought something in like December, you would get to use it for 1 month. Or if you bought, say, something in like February, you'd use it for 10. So, you know, normally you would, you know, put, say if you used it for 10, something for 10 months, you would put 10 divided by 12 times whatever the depreciation for the year is. But then if you use something for just 1 month, you would take like 1/12 of it. But what the way that's, that CRA works is they say, if you buy something during a given year, we're just going to let you take half the depreciation for that year. So sometimes you'll be, you know, over on one side. Sometimes you'll be under on the other side. But on average, for whatever everything you buy, you'll be using it for an average of 6 months in the first year that you own it. So that's where the half-year rule comes from. So if you have, for example, something that you buy for $1,000 and the declining balance rate is 30%, so instead of, or say it's 20%, so instead of taking 200 of CCA in the first year, you only take half, you take 100. That's what the half-year rule is. So back to what I was talking about, how CCA can be completely different than depreciation, you know, based on, you know, a fair and accurate assessment of the assets of the company. A couple of years ago, during the recession, they want to encourage businesses buying equipment. So what they did, especially for computer equipment and all kinds of stuff like that, normally computers are depreciated, I think it's 40 or 45% per year. That doesn't mean you get it's worth zero after two, because remember, declining balance, you know, if something is 50% declining balance, it loses half of its value in the first year, then a quarter of its value in the second year, then 1/8 of its value. So it's not, if you have declining balance 50%, something doesn't hit zero after 2 years, right? It's just every year it's worth half of what it was worth before. What they did is they said, okay, if you buy stuff like, I think it was 2009 or 2010, full depreciation the first year with no half-year rule. So what did I do with my old environmental stats business? I went out and I bought like 20 grand worth of stuff. Because boom, I could depreciate it, you know, instead of having to buy something and then just take the depreciation a little bit over the life of the asset, I could just get the full deduction as if it was the current expense. So lots of people did that. But what ended up on my, up until then, you know, I've been doing my own accounting statements for about 10, 12 years. It was so complicated for me, I would just use CCA as my actual depreciation schedule in my financial statements. But then what happened with this is I bought 20 grand worth of stuff, and then after the year is over, it shows on my balance sheet, I own nothing, right? The company has no, is worth zero, there's no assets, but I got 20 grand worth of brand new stuff in my basement, right? So what did I do? Then I ended up doing, you know, straight line 5 years for my equipment, and then I took the full depreciation in the first year for the asset. So that's an example of where it doesn't make sense. It actually makes sense to have a different accounting depreciation than a tax depreciation, and then the difference ends up being something called the I think deferred income tax or something. Deferred taxes or something like that. But it's when you have a difference between what your depreciation on your for your tax return is versus what the actual depreciation for accounting purposes. So how does CCA work? Most of it splits things into classes. So here are some examples. You know, buildings. I made those slides like, you know, 5 years ago when I first started teaching this course. Some of the percentages are out of date, but the concept is the same. You have different, for example, now the building I'm buying, it's I think building bought after 2007 or something like that, it says all other non-residential building, the rate is 6%. So what that means is every year, like I'm buying a building that's worth, well, I'm paying $450 for the property, but it's about like $180 for the land and $270 for the building. So land never depreciates. When you put land on a balance sheet, it always stays at the original cost. You don't have, you know, accumulated depreciation of land. Land is carried at cost on the balance sheet. But the build, the structure that's on that land, depreciate. Especially if you saw the old building that I bought, you would see how depreciated it is. It goes down in value 6% per year. If you have other assets, so if you have an aircraft, that'd be a nice problem to have. If you have cars, so cars go down by, they have a lot of weird rules, but you got to know these things when you do your tax return. For example, cars, it's a 30% declining balance. And make sure that if you don't understand the difference between declining balance depreciation and straight line depreciation, you know, pull up your accounting textbook and read the, figure out what the difference is. For cars, it's so there all the different types of things that a business would own are put into these different class. And then CRA tells you by how much you can depreciate them each year. So cars are at 30%. But there's another twist in cars in that you can only, you can't go and buy like a $100,000 Mercedes-Benz and depreciate it. The because that was a way that that business owner, small business owner would pay themselves, right? The company, you know, you own like 2-3 Mercedes-Benz, one for the husband, one for the wife, you know, one for the kid, and they're all business expenses. So what CRA did is they said you can only claim capital cost allowance on the first 30,000 of a car. So if you buy a car for a business, if you're buying a car that's paying more than 30,000 on, you're losing out on the tax deductibility of the depreciation. So if you buy it, if you're running a business, don't buy a car, you know, buy a car, maybe they raise that 30,000 because of inflation, but anyway, so that's where, you know, 10.1 goes. Class 12 is, you know, random stuff, like small stuff. Yeah?
If you bought 10 cars for 30,000, could you depreciate them?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just, what was happening, you know, 10, 20 years ago, business owners would pay them by having a luxury automobile as, you know, included as part of their business. But if you have like, you know, five, you know, Fords, that's all right. But they just didn't want business owners to evade taxes by their business buying themselves a really nice car and putting that as a, even if you own a Mercedes, you paid it $100,000 for, you still get to deduct depreciation on the first 30,000. It's just you're losing out on the rest. It's not if the car's worth more than 30, you can't deduct at all. It's just that you can only deduct up to 30,000. But you can have multiple cars at 30,000. So, you know, one for you, one for your wife, one for your, and three cars for your three kids, that's fine. The next one is small stuff that costs under $100. So that's 100% rate, but you would think, oh, that means that it's basically the same as a current expense. Not quite. Remember the half-year rule. So if you have something that's in class 12, you'll get 100% rate, but with the half-year rule, what's going to happen is you'll get 50% the year you buy the thing and 50% the next year. Then most companies have a lot of things in class 8. That's, furniture, because it says property, that's not included in any other class. So it could be, you know, your office furniture, photocopiers, your telephones, if you have a garage, like tools that cost $200 or more. If they're 200 or less, I won't put that in an exam, but I just want to let you know so you know what's going on. Class 8, typically, that's where you put all your desk and chairs and, you know, other stuff like that. So pretty much all of the classes are in CCA are declining balance. There's only two special exceptions that I know of. The first one is leasehold improvements. If you rent something, say, for 5 years, and you spend, you know, $50,000 fixing it up, you know, putting like new carpet and, you know, decorating, putting, you know, you own like maybe a know, clothing store, put mirrors, changing rooms, that kind of stuff, what you call leasehold improvements, those you get to depreciate straight line over the life of the lease. So if you spend $50,000 and your lease is for 5 years, then you get $10,000 CCA for leasehold improvements per year. The other one is, that's happening with me now, I'm buying a franchise, it's $25,000, but that's a franchise for 10 years. So then the franchise becomes an intangible asset, and I don't know what CCA class it is, I'll figure it out when I do my first year income tax. But then you just, over whatever the life of that intangible asset is, then you have a straight line. So those are examples of different classes. You don't have one line per asset. Because imagine if you're like, I don't know, say you're like Canadian Tire. Right? You're not going to have one line for every single cash register that you have. They're grouped into those classes. So you don't have to provide CRA the detail of, you know, I own like a Dell computer, and then I own a Mac computer, and then I own a Xerox printer. They're all into a single class. And those are the classes that you saw before, the different numbers. When you sell an asset, that's important. We'll see that later in the course when we do, for example, the buy versus lease financial analysis, and we're looking at the tax effect of owning something or leasing it. When you own an asset, and then when you sell it at the end, there's three things that can happen. If you sell it for the exact same price that it's currently, your current undepreciated capital cost for it is, there's nothing that happens. If you sell it for more, then you have what's called recapture, because here's the idea. You buy an asset, you claim depreciation over the life of the asset, then you get rid of it, then you salvage it. If you sell it for a higher price, then if you sell it, so that's the UCC, say zero. And that's at year five, that's your UCC at year five. And you sell the asset. So what happens? If you sell it, so we call it the fair market value, right? What you get to sell it for. If you sell it at exactly the same price as what you're carrying it on your depreciation schedule, there's no tax effect because you've basically depreciated it to that value. If you sell it for more, then that's called a recapture. You have all these weird terms and you know, the tax depreciation, they all have their own words for it. The recapture is the difference between, so in that case, say you bought something for 10 grand and you depreciated it, say, to 2,000, but then you sell it used for 3,000. FMV, you'll see that also, it means fair market value. So if you sell it for, say, 3,000, but it was depreciated, so you took a CCA expense down to 2,000, but you sell it for 3, you will have to pay taxes on the $1,000. So then what happens is you add 1,000 into your income. It's called recapture. If you sell it for less, you sell it for, say, not, you just get rid of it. It's dead. You know, you can't get any money for it. You know, it could be, say, zero. Maybe you sell it for 1,000. It doesn't matter. The difference then in that case, say the fair market value is zero, right? The car is such in bad shape that you just go drop it off at the scrapyard and that's it. Then the difference then would be called a terminal loss. And then you reduce your taxable income by that amount. So if you sell it at exactly what it's
what it's depreciated to. Nothing happens. You sell it at more. There's recapture. You sell it at less. You add the loss to that year's tax return. The special case that happens sometimes, well, it's what you call a nice problem to have, is say you sell it for more. Say you sell this thing for $15,000. I don't know, maybe, you know, you bought like a, you know, like a vintage like Ferrari or something like that, you know, depreciated it, but now, you know, mostly that happens with land and buildings. We'll say land or a building or something like that. If you sell it for more than your original cost, then what would happen is this. You would have recapture. You would have recapture at the regular tax rate up to the original cost. And then after that, the part above the original cost would then be considered a capital gain. And then only 50% of it gets included in your income. That's how capital gains work. I won't get into that much more detail because I'm sure you'll take, you know, a tax court at some point. But that's what happens with depreciation. When you go to sell something, that's what happens. If it's different than what you're carrying it at the, if you sell it for a different price than it's under, undepreciated capital cost, then you either get a recapture, a terminal loss, or a recapture and a capital gain if you sell it for more than you bought it for. So let's do an example. So you buy something for $100,000. Now the reason why this thing is at the declining balance rate on class 8 is 20%. So what that means is every year you're allowed to take a depreciation expense for 20% of what it was worth at the end of the last year. But in the first year, you got that half-year rule. And so instead of, if the CCA rate for something is 20%, then in the first year, you only get to deduct half of it. So your CCA deduction will be $10,000. So at the end of the year, for your tax depreciation schedule, those photocopiers are going to be worth $90. And so you carry that forward. Whatever something was worth at the end of the previous year, that's what it's worth at the beginning of the next year. So the UCC at the end of the last year is the same as the UCC at the start of the next year. And now, for the second year, you get to do the full 20%. So in that case, that would be $18,000. So the question is, how much CCA will be claimed in 2004 and 2005 combined? The answer is $28,000.
So I think it was overly optimistic that I would get into Chapter 10 today. So I will do chapter 10 starting next Tuesday. I won't be able to do that much in 10 minutes, so it's not worth it. Okay, don't forget, if you want to do the Sun Belt thing, I have 2 spots open. So send me an email, and then at next class, because there's always more people that want in than what I can handle. So send me an email, and I will randomly select 2 people. But I need to get an email from you before next class. Or the other thing, too, is if you have another business in mind or a specific industry or a specific postal code, send me an email. The TA will give you a list of businesses.